Nu is het tijd voor keynote speaker van vanavond, Errol Balkan. Ik moet even iets over hem vertellen, dat jullie hem een beetje in context kunnen plaatsen. Er is een groeiende beweging van ontwerpers en softwareontwikkelaars die nieuwe diensten willen ontwikkelen die vrijheid beschermen, privacyvriendelijk zijn en tegelijkertijd toegankelijk en aantrekkelijk voor een groot publiek. Errol Balkan is een van de meest uitgesproken voorvechters van dit soort onafhankelijke technologieën. Met zijn platform Indie maakt hij alternatieven voor privacy schendende diensten. We hebben hem gevraagd om meer te vertellen over de noodzaak en toekomst van onafhankelijke technologieën, in de hoop dat hij veel anderen inspireert om bij te dragen aan dit onderwerp. Errol, would you please take the floor? Yep.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Your Minister of Justice and Security sounds like a lovely guy. But we all know that government surveillance is bad. It's very easy to identify as a threat. We have all of this scary symbolism around it. We have history, the hindsight of history. We have the Stasi, for example. We have a very strong canon, Orwell, Huxley. And yet, is it the only threat? Is it today even the most important threat? What if surveillance didn't look this scary? What if it actually looked, well, pretty friendly? Could we still identify it as a threat? So let's go back to the beginning and try and find out. Let's look at a very fundamental concept, privacy. If I was to say to you, let's have a private conversation, you would understand what that means, right? It means that we're having a conversation and it's just me and you and no one else. So that's a very clear thing. But what does, for example, Facebook think privacy is? So if we're having a private conversation on Facebook, you might think it's the same thing, right? It's just you and me and we're having a conversation, it's just us. But that's not the reality of it. In reality, we're not even in a public space like a park. We're in Facebook's home. And it's the home of this weird stranger who pays the rent by knowing as much about us as he can. So if you're having a private conversation on Facebook, things work a little differently. First of all, you tell this stranger what you want him to relay to your friend. The stranger takes notes, and he never forgets. And then he tells your friend your message, relays it, right? So when Facebook says private, what they're really saying is public. So George Orwell, in his novel 1984, had a name for this. He called it doublethink. So to understand what Facebook means when they say private, we doublethink. So you might say, think. So you might say, Errol, it's okay. You know what? These people who run Facebook, we trust them. They're nice guys, you know? They're good people. So let's take a look. Let's take a look at the person behind Facebook. Mark Zuckerberg. In 2010, in an interview with The New Yorker, he admitted to having had an instant messenger conversation when he had just set up Facebook at Harvard. Here's how that conversation transpired. Zuckerberg says, yeah, so if you ever need any info about anyone at Harvard, just ask. I have over 4,000 emails, pictures, addresses, SMS. 4,000, this is when it was really young, right? And his friend goes, what? How'd you manage that one? And Zuckerberg says, people just submitted it. I don't know why. It gets better. They trust me. And here's the best bit. Dumb fucks. Dumb fucks. That's a great phrase, isn't it? Now, you might say, hey, this was a long time ago, Zuck was young, and you know, I'm sure the intervening years of astronomic fame and fortune have only made him more nuanced and contemplative in his outlook towards us. Or maybe not, as the recent emotional contagion study that came out, that was published by Facebook, had everyone up in arms. They were studying the effect. Only negative posts from your friends, or only positive posts from your friends. How would that make you feel emotionally? They didn't really ask anyone's consent for this, and they wrote a paper about it, and they published it, and people went crazy. They were like, how can you do this without asking us, right? And so they were very apologetic. So Sheryl Sandberg actually apologized and said, this was part of ongoing research companies do to test different products. In other words, guys, this is what we do. This is kind of what we do. And that was what it was, right? We're going to keep doing it. It was poorly communicated. And for that communication, we apologize. We never meant to upset you. She could have ended that sentence, dumb fucks. And maybe we deserve it. Because if you look at some of the media coverage, should Facebook manipulate users? That's a stupid question. It's their business to manipulate users. The mistake they made was to publish a study, an academic study. They study users every day. We are the lab rat. That is the value that they sell to their actual customers. So that is the business model of not just Facebook, but of Twitter, of Google, of nearly every Silicon Valley company that you know of. If this business model is so widespread, we need a name so that we can talk about it. What do we call it? Well, in the days, maybe 20 years ago, of personal computers, when you installed something on floppy disks, you remember those? When you installed something, an application, and it didn't do what you thought it was doing, or if it did more, if it stole some of your information or took some of your information, if it did something you didn't think it was going to do, we called it spyware. But spyware, like government surveillance, was kind of cloak and dagger, right? It was very easy to identify as malware. This isn't that generation of spyware. This is what I call spyware 2.0. And spyware 2.0 is colorful. It's cute little doodles. It's privacy dinosaurs. Have you guys seen the privacy dinosaur on Facebook? Just wants to take care of you and love you. It's kittens. That's spyware 2.0. And you might say, Aral, you know what? It's fine. Okay, this is how these companies make money, and I'm okay with that, right? If that's the case, you are going to love my new startup. Startups are cool, right? It's called Snail Mail. And with Snail Mail, we have solved a very important problem. We have solved the problem of real mail. You will get free real mail forever. You can send as many packages as you want, as many letters as you want, to as many people in the world as you want, free forever. Who thinks this is a great idea? I know you're kind of a biased audience, but I see hands. You know, I have spotlights in my eyes. I still see hands going up. Thank you for your honesty. There is a caveat. We do open and read your letters, but we only do this so that we can give you helpful hints and suggestions from what? Thank you. I don't know if that was enthusiastic because you want it or. Not gonna go there. Only so, you know, from what we've understood, it might be right or it might be wrong, but don't worry, because we'll put it all back in the envelope and you wouldn't even know that we were there. Who'd still use snail mail? I can't, there's always one. So, there you go. Thank you, sir. I think it's a sir. It's, yeah. The rest of you, you use Gmail, right? Now, there may not be people reading your letters, but there are algorithms reading your letters. So that's snail mail. Please tell your friends about it. Snailmail.com. I think it's going to be big. We're very excited about this new startup. You might say, Aral, you know what? Okay. I am willing to exchange a certain amount of my privacy for this valuable service that I get. And you know what? It's my privacy. It's a selfish decision. It doesn't concern anyone else. So, you know, butt out. I beg to differ. Because if you use Gmail, you're not just saying it's okay for Google to read my mail. You're also saying it's okay for Google to read the email that anyone sends to me. And if you don't have, if you have a custom domain, if you're not using gmail.com, they may not even know that you've made that decision for them. So in that case, in that sense, this isn't a selfish decision. This concerns others as well. So it's much more like secondhand smoke. It doesn't just affect you. It has secondary effects in your social sphere. And why do these companies do it? Are they evil? Are they like, you know, in a bunker somewhere, like Dr. Evil we saw earlier? Maybe, I don't know. But I don't think so. And we don't need that to explain their behavior. They do it because it is their business model. That is how they make money. Just like the plant in the musical Little Shop of Horrors, Audrey 2, that's a mutant plant from outer space. It starts out as a little sapling, and it needs drops of blood to grow, and then it ends up eating whole human beings. Companies like Google and Facebook need your data to grow. It is their food. It is how they make their money. It is that simple. You don't need conspiracy theories when you have the simplicity of business models. So how do they get your data? A variety of ways, right? Services. Google started out as a service, as a sapling. It was just search. They weren't even tracking you initially. But today, it's a very different beast. It's a plethora of services. You want somewhere to put your files? Put it on Google Drive. You want to talk with your friends and put them on, talk with them on Google Hangouts. Will Google be watching and analyzing what you do? Of course, it's their business model. Will they look through all your files on Google Drive? Of course, it's their business model to do that. Don't be surprised if they're acting in line with their business model. And there are games. ReCAPTCHA, who's filled out a CAPTCHA, ReCAPTCHA online, right? It protects forms, that's the value they give us, but at the same time, they, if they have a street sign that they've photographed with Google Street View and they can't read it, they get you to help them out. Okay, that's kind of cool. They're actual games. Who's played Ingress here on their free game, right? Free game. You walk around town and there's been an alien invasion and you're playing in groups and you have to find the quickest way to get from one landmark to another and then hack into it and then play a part in stopping this alien invasion. So that's the story. But what you're really doing is you're giving Google very hard to come by data on pedestrian walking patterns. They don't have the resources to go in and find all of those routes between those landmarks. So that's why they need you, because you are the lab rat. You are a resource, right? So you might say, Aral, okay, wow, you scared us from the services, we'll just stop using them. It's too easy. Google will lose. Google can't lose, right? So what's the next step if your business model is to monetize data? Well, they're devices. What if I gave you a beautiful, gorgeous device like a Nexus phone? It's a great experience. Google understands user experience now, right? And why is this phone half the price of an iPhone? Do they have twice the economies of scale? I mean, Tim Cook is meant to be a supply chain guy. Is he asleep at the wheel? I don't think so. This is just a gorgeous data entry device, right? And the beauty of it is, because we make your sign-in to your device, your Google username and password, it doesn't matter what app you used, we're still going to get some valuable data. And that's what we need. Same with their tablets. Same with their laptops. But you might say, okay, Aral, wow, you scared me. I'm not going to use their laptops. I'm not going to use their tablets, right? And they're trying to get those laptops into schools.
That's really scary. If we normalize surveillance in education, that's going to affect the next generation. But you might say, no, we're not going to do any of that. And Google's lost. But Google can't lose. So if you make money by monetizing data, what's your end game? It's connectivity. It's connecting people to the internet with things like Google Fiber. Because if I can make your login to the internet, your Google username and password, it doesn't matter what device you use. I will still get some valuable information. And not just from you. Have you guys heard of the next 5 billion? Yeah, they're really excited about this in Silicon Valley. The next 5 billion are these poor souls in parts of the world where they can't connect to the internet, they don't have the resources. And there's nobody locally who could fix this problem, of course. So the white man has to bring the fire, right? With things like balloons with Google Loon or internet.org, which is already working, where they're giving free internet, but it's not the full internet. It's only Facebook and a few other services. So in the future, there might be a whole nation whose notion of the internet is something you sign into with your Google username or password or your Facebook username and password. And that's quite a bleak future to look forward to. And it's also what I call digital imperialism. It is a new form of colonialism. So that's data about you. But there's more data in the world, right? And Google needs that data as well. So how do they get it? They've got satellites, of course. They've got maps, beautiful. Google Street View. Who's seen the Google Street View car here? Yeah, who's done something funny while I was going by? Yeah, but there's some places they can't go with a car, and they need the data. So there's the Google Street View trike for places you can't go with a car, but you need the data, right? And if you can't go there with a trike, there's the Google Street View snowmobile. You can use that. And if you can't go there with a snowmobile, maybe it's indoors, there's the Google Street View trolley for that. And if you can't go there with a trolley, but you need the data, there is the Google Street View backpack. And I saw this the other day. I shit you not. Now, do you kind of get the feeling they need the data? Do you? Talk about Apple. They got a different business model, my friend. They sell products. They don't sell your data. But we can talk about them. They're not great. They're closed. But they are a very different company. So that's why I'm not talking about Apple. But thank you for bringing it up. So if you go to the extent of putting a camera on a camel, you probably need data, right? But even if they arrived at your home or at your business wearing one of those backpacks, or hopefully because of it, you probably wouldn't let them into your business or into your home. So again, in these really personal, private spaces, they need you. Have you heard of Project Tango, the latest phone from Google? So it's really great. It has a depth sensing camera. You buy it, you take it home, you walk around, and it maps the inside of your house in three dimensions. It has object recognition, so it can recognize what objects you have, right? Why? Because Google Street View can't come into your home, right? Although I saw a parody where, you know, they went around and they knocked on the door saying they were Google Street View, and some people let them in. But you wouldn't. You wouldn't. Why? Because you are the lab rat. So why are they doing this? Is it just the data? The data is important. The data are the atoms, right? But what's much more valuable is when we combine all of these pieces of information about you. Because if we can do that, then we can create a profile of you. And that's really valuable. And here's why. Because I can't take you, and I can't put you in a lab somewhere, and I can't study you and poke you to find out how you feel, how I can manipulate you best 24 hours a day, because we have laws against that. It's called kidnapping, right? We can't do that. That's no-no, right? But what if I know so much about you that I can create a simulation of you? Well, I can take that simulation, I can put that in my lab, and I can study that 24 hours a day. There are no laws that protect your simulation, right? And that is really, really valuable. So, what is the end game? What are we trying to do? What does all of this combine into? Data about the world, data about all of us. What do we get if we combine all of that? Well, we get what I would call the camera panopticon. And you might say, Aral, okay, so they're building this camera panopticon that knows everything about the world and everything about us. And that's probably a useful tool for manipulating behavior, for even, depending on how good your lens is, in predicting the future and creating it. But at least they don't share it with governments, right? Well, wrong, of course. Since 9/11, things have changed. In the US, they formed this, the Information Awareness Office, with the publicly stated goal of attaining total information awareness, knowing everything about everyone and everything. Now, if you're gonna do that, this was their real logo. Don't make this your logo. Really? People get scared with a pyramid with an all-seeing eye shooting laser beams at the world. So people got scared. And they were like, we were kidding. We're just going to shut it down, right? That was a joke. And of course, they didn't shut it down. As Edward Snowden's revelations showed last year, and we'll be hearing from him tonight, the NSA really needs to hire a PowerPoint designer. But apart from that, all of these companies that we trusted with our most personal data, we realized we're sharing it with the government. All of this data that we thought, well, easy. Because data that you have volunteered to a third party is not under the same protections under the law. It's so much easier for them to go to one place and to ask them for information you have volunteered. It's like a drive-through McDonald's or something. You know, if you're an agency, it's just like all this data in one place, and I just have to ask. It's beautiful, right? So like Bruce Schneier says, the NSA didn't just wake up and say, let's spy on everybody. They looked up and said, wow, corporations are spying on everybody. Let's get ourselves a copy, right? So if this is the case, I'm sure these corporations take it really seriously. So let's listen to Eric Schmidt, see what he thinks about this. There's been surveillance for years. I'm not going to pass judgment on that. It's the nature of our society. Okay, well, what should we do, Eric?
If you have something that you don't want anyone to know, maybe you shouldn't be doing it in the first place.
If you have something you don't want anyone to know, maybe you shouldn't be doing it in the first. Why didn't we think of this? This is it. We can all go home, people. Problem solved. But you know, I know Eric, and he's a stand-up guy. And he didn't just say this. He felt it. He means it. And so he went out after this and created a series of websites to prove to the world that he believes this. Some of my favorites that he created, he put his own photos, his own videos up there, are ericstoiletantics.com. You know, he gets up to little antics in this toilet. There's ericsfavoritesexytimes.com. He's got quite an imagination. He does. You wouldn't think it. But my favorite one is ericsmasturbationadventures.com. It's not my thing. But of course, none of these websites exist. And if they're... And if there are any developers in the room, nor should they. Because that's not what privacy is about. Privacy is not about whether or not you have something to hide. It's about having the right to choose what you want to keep to yourself and what you want to share with others. It's a fundamental human right that we have seen fit to enshrine in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, in Article 12 specifically. So when these companies that need your data, that don't respect your privacy, tell you, oh my gosh, we are fighting for your privacy, right? If they build things like reform government surveillance and say, we're fighting for your privacy, the government is evil. There is a term for that. It is bullshit, right? It is bullshit and it is misdirection. This is a cornerstone of magic. Don't look at what this hand is doing, look at what this hand is doing, right?
because privacy is fundamentally incompatible with their business models. All they can offer you is the illusion of privacy. As Michael Novak, a Facebook product engineer manager, said, now we're thinking about privacy as a set of experiences that help people feel comfortable. Doesn't that make you feel good? So this business model of free itself is a lie. It's more than that. It's a con. They need to con us to use it. This is venture capital backed. If something's venture capital backed, you've already sold your users from day one. That's what you sell to your investors. Investors invest in the exit, not the business. You go to them and you say, I'm going to have 400 million people using my platform in 4 years' time. How much will you give me for them? And they say, we'll give you 10 million because they want 100 million back. You've already sold out. But it's more than a lie and it's more than a con. It's also a monopoly, and that's what makes it so dangerous. And we have the long tail of it. You guys love startups? Startups are great, right? Like Spritz. Spritz is an awesome startup. It's a new way of reading. It's probably the first new way of reading since reading, right? And it's great for things like watches. It's awesome. It's wonderful. And it's spyware. I was with their CEO at an event, and I said, how do you make money? He said, well, we know what you're reading, right? And then at the conference, he said, we really would like more people to build email apps with our SDK, which you can download for free. Wouldn't that be great? Startup is not a new company. It's a very specific type of new company. And it is the long tail of spyware. And we've been conned as consumers, but we've also been conned as developers, as people who are technically savvy. Remember the open web? That really worked out well, didn't it? Right? Remember this guy? Tim O'Reilly, who said, Web 2.0, APIs. Wouldn't it be great if we had open APIs for everything and you could build products that, like, you could build Twitter apps and you could use Twitter's open API and we're building the open web? Well, that was bullshit, right? Whereas free is the lie told to consumers, open API was the lie told to us in Web 2.0 because an API key is a key to a lock that you do not own, which can be changed at any time by someone else. And why do I say this? Because it's very pertinent today. Because the next generation of Web 2.0 that's being sold to us as developers, as designers, is the Internet of Things. There is no Internet of Things. There is only the Internet of Data. You guys have heard of Nest, right? The smart thermostat that you put in your home that knows when you're home, it knows when you're not home, right? The company that bought that, you might know them, they're a little company called Google. They bought them in January for $3.2 billion. Now, they said the customer data will be separate from Google. Okay. And then in June, they bought a camera that you put in your home, and it watches your home. But they said Google didn't buy it. Nest bought it. And their CEO said, I know it's a bit hard to follow, but CEO said, like Nest customer data, Dropcam will come under Nest's privacy policy. Everything's okay, right? And that was 4 days after Nest to share user information with Google for the first time, June 20th to June 24th, 4 days afterwards. That headline might as well end Dumb Fox, right? Because what were we doing? We're going, hey, the water's getting really warm. It's nice and comfortable, isn't it? Unaware that the fire burns underneath. So the Internet of Things, unless you as an individual, unless we have ownership and control, is the Internet of Things that spy on you in your own home. Wearables, the quantified self, unless you have ownership and control of that technology and that data, is the surveilled self. So, thank you. That was personal to someone there. That's the problem, okay? But technology itself is not the problem. As Melvin Kranzberg says, technology is neither good nor bad. Nor is it neutral. So what is the solution? The solution is an ethical approach to design. This is a design problem, right? So I'm going to present you with the three R's of design. Let's co-opt Maslow's hierarchy of needs for this. What if we started as a base with human rights? What if we started designing so that it respects human rights, the first R? But we can't stop there. We do that with free software, right? We say, our software respects human rights. Is it really horribly hard to use? Pfft, okay, that's fine. Try harder, right? No,
Because the next layer is we have to respect human effort. That's the second R. We can't be arrogant and say, learn how to use this. No one's going to use it. They haven't. No consumers are. The internet is built on the stuff. Yes. Consumers, none of them are using it. And what about the top bit? Well, how about we go beyond effort and we respect the human experience? We try to make the lives of the people who use our products, our objects that we make, as beautiful as possible. And that is respect for the human experience. I call this the hierarchy of product ethics. It's a backronym. And it stands for hope. And I really think that this is really important because what we're failing at today in the consumer space is this bit. And without that, we're building, if it doesn't respect human rights, we're building our products on the shoulders of people, not for them. We're building them so that they usurp people, and the rest of it just crumbles. So if you want to know what is spyware, it is venture capital subsidized, it will masquerade as free, it'll be closed, not open, it'll be centralized so that everything's in one place, and it'll be homogenous in it differently. And that's what we're trying to do differently. And that's what we're trying to do with independent technology. Independent technology, in contrast, is independently funded. You take venture capital, you're part of the system, you've lost, right? We don't take venture capital. You need to build systems, companies that are sustainable. There are other ways of doing that. It needs to be free and open, the products that we make. The products that we make have to be distributed in their topology, so there are no centers. Decentralized is not good enough. Decentralized means there are still centers. When there are economies of scale, those centers will coalesce and grow, and we will be left with the monopolies that we have on the web today. The web today is not an anomaly. There is no bug. The web is functioning exactly as designed. It was a client-server system. It was decentralized. It coalesced into a centralized one. That is the natural life cycle of that topology. We need to go beyond that to build things where there are no centers, where every node is equal. And in doing these, we have to build teams that are diverse. Middle-aged white men building things for other middle-aged white men is not going to solve this problem. And that's one of the biggest problems we have in the free and open world. And here's the problem. If you want the problem at its core, this is the problem. In order to share something with your friend, you shouldn't also have to share it with a stranger. You should be able to share it directly with them. This is not a complicated problem, and it doesn't require a complicated solution. And if anyone tells you it's a complicated problem, they probably have a vested interest in it appearing to be complicated. If we can do this, then we can start people off in their own homes, not in the home of a known abuser. We can start them off somewhere that is safe, not start them off somewhere that's unsafe and say, protect yourself. And if we can do this, then we can build products that actually protect our human rights, that protect our fundamental freedoms, that protect democracy. Now, this is the future I want to live in. This is the future that we must build. This is the future that humanity deserves. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks, man.
Great. Okay.